Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2022. Before we begin, could I remind those committee members using electronic devices to switch them to silent? We have apologies from Finlay Carson, our convener, who won't be at committee for a few weeks, and we wish him a speedy recovery. We have substitute Edward Mountain today, and could I invite Edward to declare any relevant interests?
Thank you, convener. My register of interest declares all my interests, but in summary, I would say that I am a part of a family farming partnership. I farm 500 acres and I'm tenant of another 500 acres. I grow barley and beef cattle, and there are some ancillary let properties. I have a 50% share in a salmon fishery on the River Spey. I'm also a chartered surveyor, although I am not practising at the moment, but it's one of my qualifications. Any other details that the committee need to see are laid out in my register of interest, convener.
Thank you. Thank you, Edward. Agenda item one, our first item of business today is to decide whether to take item four in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. Agenda item two, the draft joint fisheries statement. Our second item of business this morning is two evidence sessions on the draft joint fisheries statement. First, we'll take evidence from stakeholders, followed by a session with the Cabinet Secretary and Scottish Government officials. So I welcome this morning our panel of stakeholders attending remotely. Professor James Harrison, University of Edinburgh. Elspeth MacDonald, Chief Executive Officer, Scottish Fishermen's Federation. Helen McLachlan, Future Fisheries Alliance. Charles Miller, Executive Director, Sustainable Inshore Fisheries Trust. And Elaine White from the Communities Inshore Fisheries Alliance. I would now like to invite questions from members. And I shall... Bear with me. There's a question. Too many bits of paper here. Yeah. So could I invite the stakeholders to elaborate on their view that the draft joint fisheries statement lacks ambition in setting out a new post-EU's fisheries framework for the UK? And if I could start... If I could start with Professor Harrison, please.
Okay, good morning, convener. Good morning, committee. Thank you for this opportunity to talk to you. I mean, there are various things that this joint fisheries statement has to achieve. And I think the first thing is it's designed to be part of a common framework, and we need to remember what its prime objectives are, and that's to ensure some sort of consistency in the way that the four fisheries administrations in the UK proceed in implementing their own measures over the years to come. So inevitably, there is going to be some flexibility for each of the fisheries administrations, but equally, I think in order to achieve its ultimate objectives, the joint fisheries statement has to have enough in there to ensure that there is consistency. And a balance has to be struck between those two things. And for certain issues, I think the balance is probably about right. Issues like co-management, there are lots of different models across the UK. There's no reason we need a single co-management model in all the jurisdictions. On other issues, if there's too much inconsistency of approach, I think there could be problems down the line. One example I might give would be discards. The idea of four separate discards regimes without much coherence between them could cause problems both in terms of fishing operations, but also in terms of enforcement. So I think how that balance is struck will vary from policy to policy. And sometimes it gets it right. Sometimes I think there are questions to be asked about how that balance between consistency and flexibility is struck. I imagine there'll be further questions on the fisheries objectives and the interpretation of those, and I certainly have things to say on that. And I also imagine there'll be questions about the fisheries management plans, which I think is where there is a real lack of ambition. But I don't want to take too much time in a preliminary observation if we're going to come back to those.
We are. Thank you. Thank you. Can I move on to Elspeth MacDonald, please?
Convener, and thank you for inviting me to speak to the panel today. I agree with some of the comments that the Professor has just made in terms of this being part of a framework, a much broader framework. And I think it's important that we understand, I think, the complexity, actually, of what officials have been attempting to do here in trying to draft something that gives that sort of coherence where coherence is necessary, but flexibility where that is desirable. I think where we would see a lack of ambition is in terms of moving away from the constraints of the Common Fisheries Policy and the rules that have been set there for many years and that the industry has had to follow. It feels that these are sort of very small steps in terms of moving away from the regulatory regime that we currently have and perhaps missing an opportunity to look more innovatively and more, when I say radically, I don't mean that in a cavalier way, but perhaps sort of taking a different approach. And I think some of the text around the landings obligation, the means of managing discards in future, and the fact that it is not taking us terribly far away from the landings obligation in terms of what we see here is an example of that. So I think we don't underestimate the difficulties of drafting a document like this. I think it is really challenging to strike that right balance, but I think we see we would have liked to see more ambition set out here. I think there are a number of areas of inconsistency too that I'm sure we'll touch on as we go through the session today. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I ask Helen McLachlan for her comments?
Thank you, and thanks for the opportunity to be here this morning. I think from the Future Fisheries Alliance perspective, that's an alliance that represents WWF, RSPB and the Marine Conservation Society. I'd agree with quite a few of the comments previously in terms of there are a lot of things to be welcomed in the statement, but there is an overwhelming lack of detail, I think, in terms of how some of those welcome statements will actually be delivered. So in terms of actually how they will be met, we're at a point now where we have the opportunity to do things differently. And if we look across our marine environment, we're not doing very well with, almost sort of under 70% of assessed stocks in a healthy state. And that's more when you take in those stocks that we don't have data for. We have large amounts of bycatch of sensitive species being caught in fisheries. And I think to improve things, we need to do some things quite differently. And I'm not sure we're convinced that there's enough evidence of what that will be within the JFS. And a couple of examples. We appreciate the sensitivities of devolution and four nations coming together and being respectful of the settlements. But for example, in climate change, very welcome commitment to an acknowledgement that actually the fishing sector, both the supply chain itself, has the ability to make changes to contribute to a net zero future. However, there's not very much in the detail of how that will be done. And they could have said, we actually agree that by a certain date, we will be setting out a series of milestones that we need to achieve. And that would have been something that could have been possible. And similarly, with one of the recognition that remote electronic monitoring with cameras, for example, is a key way to underpin sustainable management and really game change going forward. Again, they could have come together and said, we recognise that, and by a certain date, we will be looking at setting out how we will roll that out. And those were missed opportunities. But I'll stop there, as I'm sure we're going to pick up on various pieces as we go forward. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I invite Charles Miller for his comments?
Yes, good morning, and thank you as well for giving us the opportunity to talk today. I'm slightly echoing what you've heard from the other witnesses. You know, we welcome the concept of the JFS, you know, opportunity for a basis for coherent management regime across the different parts of the United Kingdom. We welcome the fact that it commits, the authorities to take account of the natural environment and the importance of an ecosystem-based approach. These are important things to have in there. The fisheries objectives within them are broadly sort of ones which we would endorse and adhere to. But where I think there is a lack of ambition is around, we've heard from the other stakeholders, the kind of lack of time-bound commitments and the kind of aspirational tone, if you like, of the a lot of the document, and that it's really very heavily caveated at times. And so, whilst there may be elements of it which are really quite welcome, they come with sort of they're phrased in such a way as to it clear that there's not actually a binding commitment to make certain moves in the directions which the objectives are kind of identifying. So, if you like, I'm kind of endorsing the same general thrust, I think, and I'll leave it at that because I appreciate the other things to come back to.
Thank you. And finally, Elaine White.
Thank you very much, Convener. I think I would echo a lot of the points that have been made before, but I think it's important to remember that this is a strategic overarching document, and so the detail is always going to be difficult to fill in anyway. We have four devolved nations and they will have different priorities. So I think the key is going to be in the implementation of how we interpret these things. For instance, I'm looking at points, the fact that each of the devolved nations, in fact, each of the regions in the devolved nations may have a different level of resource to deliver each of these key targets that are outlined. I know certainly in some of the regions around about Scotland, there's a very different resource even in IFGs. So how they deliver is going to be how, in relation to their capacity. I think as well, it's really important to raise the fact that we've all got different, not only different systems, but different priorities for our fisheries. So when we're talking about things in the statement, such as commercially important stocks, what's commercially important to different regions will vary. So in terms of, I think it's a very sensible idea to have one. But I don't know how it is going to square the circle of things like Northern Irish trade advantages over somewhere like Scotland. It can't. But as a strategic document, I think it's very helpful.
Thank you, Elaine. Can we move on? Can I move now on to questions from Ariane?
Thanks very much, Convener. James, you touched on this, so I'm going to direct this question to you. In your opinion, does the Joint Fisheries Statement provide enough detail to explain how the Fisheries Policy Authorities will achieve the objectives in the UK Fisheries Act?
In my view, the Draft Statement does little more than restate the objectives as assessed in the Act. It adds very little. And admittedly, for some of them, there's probably little that could be added, but I think for others, I certainly would have liked to have seen more. And in particular, I was disappointed that at the beginning of the document, there is a reference to the various international instruments, both binding and non-binding, that the UK is seeking to give effect to, but they are not then used in order to give a bit more substance to these. And the precautionary objective would be a good example. I think there's two paragraphs in the draft statement as it is that really just restate what is said in the Act about the precautionary approach. But there is a lot more that could be drawn upon from various international instruments, be it the UN Fish Stocks Agreement, be it the Food and Agriculture Organization Code of Conduct and Responsible Fisheries, which emphasize that the precautionary approach in fisheries has to be applied broadly. It's not just about a negative duty not to use a lack of science as an excuse for not taking action, but also a positive duty to always be more cautious when taking fisheries decisions. And I think these are going to be critical issues in actually giving effect. I agree completely with Elaine White that really it's going to depend on the individual measures taken by fisheries administrations in order to give effect to the Act and the statement. But the statement has to provide some guidance to them on how they do that. And at the moment, it really is lacking. And these are difficult issues. As you saw a few weeks ago when you were discussing the cod closure in the Clyde, these are very challenging issues. And the more guidance that can be in the joint fisheries statement on what the precautionary approach means, for example, what the ecosystem objective means, then the easier it might be for fisheries administrations to actually make more robust, transparent and clear decisions.
Thank you very much for that response. Is there anyone else who wants to come in on that question? If not, I'll move on. Okay. And I'd like to direct this question to firstly Charles Miller and then also Helen McLachlan. Do you have concerns about the way the Joint Fisheries Statement proposes to meet the sustainability objective, the climate objective and or the bycatch objective? In particular, do you think that the measures proposed are enforceable? Do you think that there are adequate timeframes set out, which you kind of already both mentioned in your openings? And is the language strong enough to require, rather than merely encourage, actions to be taken? So this is on these objectives, sustainability objective, the climate objective, and or the bycatch objective.
I think I kind of, without drilling down into each specific one, I think we have the same kind of problem running through all of these issues, which is that there is a lack of detail there, and in a sense we see that almost immediately. If you look, for example, at the ecosystem objective, you then look at some of the fishery management plans which have been proposed within Scotland, and the whole point of an ecosystem objective is to take everything into account, essentially. And then what we have is fishery management plans which are single species, and that seems to me to be a kind of indicator of the problems associated with this document, is that even from sort of the get-go, there is a failure to actually see the potential implementation through fishery management plans being resulting from the objectives. So somewhere along the line, there is a problem there. And I think, it is this broader lack of, as I said earlier, time-bound commitments. It's it is this aspirational nature, if you like, of the document. If we looked at some of the other, there are references at various points about exploring potential and opening up government to consideration and things like that. There's very little there that's actually binding. That's this theme that runs through it, I think that's fair to say.
Thanks very much, Charles. And I think it's really helpful that you point out that on one hand, we're trying to look at an ecosystem objective here, and meanwhile, we are singling out a single species. And maybe that's a piece around the shifting awareness of, this greater awareness of ecosystems and needing to look at the interconnectedness of everything, and then, therefore, how do we take care of a single species? Helen, can I address that question to you as well around the objectives? I'm being specific around the sustainability objective, the climate objective, or the bycatch one, but you're welcome to bring in anything else if you want to.
Thank you. I would agree with Charles. I mean, in terms of, I think we are at a point now where we realise that we do need to manage our fisheries with consideration to the broader environmental impacts. And so making sure that we put in place the ability to do that is going to be key going forward. So the fisheries management plans, we may come on to touch on those in more detail, but I think they are being seen as one of the main means of delivering on management per se, but yet the time-bound commitments to recover depleted stocks and to deliver that broader ecosystem-based approach, there's not much evidence there of exactly how that will happen. And I think we'd hope that there would be more in the JFS to touch on that. Because, we've got a whole raft of issues at the minute that really do need to take account of not just target stock, but you know, what are the what are the wider impacts, and the bycatch objective, where you're talking about the impact of fishing on sensitive species. As I said earlier, you know, we're looking at marine mammals and seabirds being caught in their thousands each year. These are issues that we have known about for I could probably say decades, in terms of things like harbour porpoise bycatch and gill nets. And we've got increasing evidence in seabird data, the impact there. And yet, the way that's being proposed is a flag to what's called a bycatch mitigation initiative, a document which we expected to be published at the end of last year, and it remains still to be published. We think it may be, you know, in May, but we're not sure. But to have a statement that flags the delivery to another document about which stakeholders have no clue what it entails is really quite a big omission in our eyes. And, you know, there are some things that we could have seen in here. We know where high-risk fisheries are. We know where some of the hotspots are. What's needed is not just more statements of we'd like to do something. It's about, okay, we're actually going to be doing X, Y, and Z. We need change in the water. We need change in those fisheries to address the mitigation of those bycatch issues, and then in turn the monitoring of those. And I think with the climate change one, what I said previously is the case. You know, we absolutely welcome the recognition, and it's absolutely true that throughout the whole of the fishery supply chain, there's a job to be done in assessing climate impact and where those can be reduced. But the detail in the statement really doesn't go much beyond consider where we can do that. It doesn't give much detail in, you know, what sort of options there might be available. So, yeah. We're hopeful that things will come down the line, but, you know, we are at a point of we need to have ambition and we need to be bold in what we do to turn things around over the coming years if we're going to meet those net zero ambitions.
Thank you, Helen. That was a very helpful response. Just wanted to pick up on you mentioned this bycatch mitigation initiative that's due to come out. Is that a Scottish Government or is it a joint document?
It's a joint administrative piece, so it should talk to all four nations, but it's unclear quite how engaged all the four nations have been in the detail of that.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Ariane. A brief supplementary from Mercedes Villalba and followed by questions from Jim Fairley.
Thanks, Convener. Just while we're on the subject of fisheries objectives, I wondered if perhaps we could hear from Elspeth MacDonald and Elaine White whether your organisations have any specific plans or policies which you propose would be needed to meet the climate change objective specifically.
Can we go to Elspeth first?
Thank you. I think the climate change objective is particularly interesting, and there are, I think, a number of points that we need to recognise here. I think something that I feel sort of flows through this document, and we haven't really touched on yet today, is and I think Professor Harrison mentioned it, what we're looking at here is something that's trying to address what are extremely complicated issues. And I think we have to recognise that we don't understand all of these issues, and there's a lot that we don't know, and there are many things that perhaps we'll never know. And I think, for example, the document touches on the importance of blue carbon in the context of the climate change objective. And there's much talk, indeed, about blue carbon, but I think we must recognise that we have a fairly limited understanding of the issues of blue carbon and what impact, if any, fishing has on that. So I think we have to be We have to be cognizant of the fact that what we're trying to do here, what this document is trying to do and what the fisheries administrations are trying to do is manage something that is extremely complicated, where there are a lot of uncertainties and unknowns. I think also in relation to the climate change objective, I think it's important to recognise that when you compare fisheries to other activities, fisheries is actually starting in a pretty good place. So if you compare the impacts of fishing in the context of food production to other protein sources, for example, we are starting in a better place. So I think it's important to see that broader context. That's not to say, of course, that there's not more things that the fishing industry can do to mitigate emissions, reduce emissions as far as possible. And that very much is a key part of the industry's activities, as it tries to make its operations more efficient and therefore more carbon efficient. So I think clearly this is going to be a really important part of our future fisheries management. But I think we just need to recognise too that our sustainable, successful fishing industry and our fisheries production is part of our journey towards net zero, and isn't just something that needs to be managed in the context of reaching net zero. We're part of that journey. There's much still to do, and there's much also that we still don't understand.
Thanks, Elspeth. Mercedes, did you invite Elaine to speak?
Yeah, if we've got time, that'd be good.
Elaine.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mercedes. Yes, we have indeed. I think we've all, as fisheries organisations, responded to the Future of Fisheries Management consultation, in which we've outlined our ambitions, which are things like looking at how we can make our fleet smarter. A lot of the inshore boats in particular are maybe up to 60 years old. So it's ways that we can potentially modernise those fleet, and we are working on a strategy at the moment to look at that, because it's very much needed. To caveat that, what I will say is that capacity is at an all-time low within the inshore fleet, just because of the many different challenges that are coming towards them. But there's a very, very strong will to look at how they can improve their environmental standing, really, as well as their efficiency. But I also think, when it comes to things like climate change and how are we understanding that in respect to resilience, I think we have to look at the resilient communities aspect of it as well. And we have to think, for instance, and somebody had mentioned the COD discussions, we now in the Clyde, for instance, have sea bottom temperatures of 8 degrees from our members. COD are usually found in 4 to 7. So that means that we might be looking at, when we talk about restoring stocks, we might not be able to restore those stocks, but we might be seeing other stocks coming in, things like, I know certainly that we have members in the Solway who are very keen to look at bass fisheries. We have members in the Western Isles who are keen to look at spur dogs fisheries. I think looking at how the climate is changing and how the stocks are changing and how we can make maybe those communities fish in a more sustainable way in reflection with their stocks is very, very important for us. But yeah, of course, we certainly take onward.
Thanks, Elaine. Can I move on to questions now from Jim Fairley?
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm going to direct this to Professor Harrison. We're talking about the international obligations and how that is worked through the whole GFS. You said in your briefing to the committee that if no international obligation exists, it would appear that the Secretary of State cannot act unilaterally, and the consent of the devolved administrations may be needed for the determining of a fishing opportunity insofar as the determination falls within the competence of a devolved administration. Can you expand on, do you have concerns about that, and can you expand on what your concerns would be?
I certainly can. So the Fisheries Act is very clear. Section 23.2, I've got it in front of me, a determination fishing opportunities may be made only for the purpose of complying with an international obligation of the UK. And I think the rationale for that is that basic principles are that fisheries are devolved, but that foreign affairs and international negotiations are reserved. So it's in those reserved areas where we've seen the Secretary of State having exclusive powers. There's a duty to consult when they're setting fishing opportunities. But I don't see in the draft statement as it is that reflection of Section 23.2 of the Fisheries Act, with this limitation on the powers of the Secretary of State to set fishing opportunities only for the purpose of complying with international obligations. And so I have a question at least about whether this is compatible with the balance that was struck in terms of devolution in the Fisheries Act. And I would, you know, certainly encourage the Fisheries Administration to look at that again and see why isn't that particular condition reflected in this fisheries statement. Because the consequences of that are that if there's not an international obligation, then the Scottish ministers should be playing a much greater role in setting fishing opportunities.
Okay, so you think that the other three devolved nations should have a much bigger say in any of those negotiations? Just to clarify, is that what you're saying?
I'm not. So where there's international negotiations, I'm saying the UK Secretary of State has the power to make the determination. But not all fishing opportunities relate to shared stocks. Hmm. And the fisheries statement gives the impression that the Secretary of State has that power to make fisheries opportunity determinations over all stocks. And that's the question I'm asking. I'm not convinced that under the Act, the Secretary of State has that power, and that ministers, Scottish ministers, where it's not a shared stock with other nations, where there's no international negotiations, then Scottish ministers should have a stronger role in determining fishing opportunities.
Okay, because I was interested in what Elaine White was talking about in her first contribution there. It's a hugely complex thing dealing with fishing. I mean, I know from a farming point of view, people talk about farming, but a hill farmer has no relation to an arable farmer in the east coast of Scotland. And it seems to be 10 times more complicated in fishing. So it would appear from Elaine's evidence, and Elaine, you might come in on this, that there needs to be a much tighter agreement with the devolved administrations to decide what's happening in their waters. Is that a fair assessment?
I mean, just to clarify, we're talking, you know, the vast majority of stocks in UK waters are shared with other countries, other neighbouring states. So in most cases, the Secretary of State is going to have that power under Section 23 of the Act. But there might be other situations where they don't, and I think that should be reflected accurately in the fisheries statement.
Okay, Elaine, what is your view?
With that there would be good to have some more clarity on it. But I think from my perspective, more of the uncertainties over unevenness of decisions or probably comes from even domestic bodies that we have. So for instance, in a region you may have marine planning, you may have Nature Scot, you may have a fisheries department, aquaculture department, renewables department, all making decisions which may not tie up, which ultimately, there's no point having quota for a species if you don't have it in the area. There's no point having quota if you can't do it because there's a renewable site there. There's those types of join-ups, I think, and it's about the capacity, I think, even at a domestic level. The strategic level, of course, that'll be for the ministers to decide, but I would say the devolved nation having as much control over its waters because it understands them the most, in the same way as I would say a local area having as much as control as it can over its area because it understands them.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Can I have a supplementary from Edward Mountain?
Thank you, Convener. I just want to push on that a little bit with James, if I may. Is surely the beauty of the fact that it's slightly vague allows the devolved administrations to discuss who should be the lead person when negotiating internationally as far as the uptake of quota when we're unable to fill that quota ourselves. So I believe we have an obligation to exploit the quota if we haven't got to the sustainable yield limit. And therefore, surely, you know, there could be some merit in Scotland taking the lead on some aspects, England taking the lead on another. And surely that's the merits of what's being suggested. Do you agree?
I think I'm making a slightly different point because I'm talking about situations where we might want to constrain fishing opportunities, but there's no international negotiation. And the point I'm trying to get across is in that situation, it shouldn't be the UK Secretary of State who is exercising that power on behalf of the devolved administrations. It should be the devolved administrations working together with the Secretary of State and jointly coming up with a fishing opportunity.
So the flip side of what I said is exactly what you've just said. So it would be the devolved administration who have the majority of that stock who may well take the lead on it and encourage every one of the devolved administrations to follow along those lines. So it achieves it both ways.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions from Alistair Allen, please?
Thank you, Convener. As we've been alluding to there, international negotiations have an impact, just as the changed landscape more generally post-Brexit has a wider social impact on fishing and other rural communities, something which I know a number of us are keen for this committee to look at specifically in the future. But how do negotiations themselves impact on delivering policies in the GFS? Can you give examples of how those negotiations determine the ability to implement those policies?
Would you want to address that?
Oh, sorry, I beg your pardon. Address it to Professor Harrison in the first instance.
I think for those stocks which are shared with other states, and that may be other coastal states in the region, there are some stocks which are paddling stocks, so they also exist on the high seas, and there's a need to negotiate with those high seas fishing states as well. There will be a significant impact upon what we can achieve domestically without cooperating with other states. It's the same stock. So there needs to be some level of coordination where there is a shared stock concern. I mean, what examples I would give to go to the fisheries management plans, I mean, a number of the stocks for which the Scottish ministers are responsible for developing fisheries management plans are shared stocks. It doesn't make sense to have a Scottish fisheries management plan, the Scottish waters, that doesn't take into account what other states are doing for the same stock in their own waters. And indeed, there are already long-term management strategies for many of the stocks listed there, such as blue whiting, Atlanto scando herring, that will have to be taken into account in the development of those fisheries management plans. So I think this complicates fisheries management hugely, where you have multiple states fishing for the same stock.
Thank you. Any other members wish to come in on that? Elspeth MacDonald.
I think perhaps another example of that sort of complexity is through the trade and cooperation agreement now between the UK and the EU, where as part of the governance of that treaty, there are a number of specialised committees which have been set up, and one of these is a specialised committee on fisheries. Now, there are, I think, around 70 shared stocks between the UK and the EU. And there will be, and indeed there have been, annual discussions, annual negotiations between the two parties on these stocks for the last 2 years. But many issues are likely to be remitted from these negotiations into that specialised committee on fisheries. And I think some of that committee has barely got off the ground at the moment yet, but we know that there will be issues that are remitted there. We know around non-quota stocks, for example, that there will be much work to be done through that specialised committee. So I think we need to recognise that delivery of some of the policies and achieving some of the objectives that are set out in the Act and through the Joint Fisheries Statement may indeed be impacted by how things are progressed and sort of move through that process through that specialised committee. So that's perhaps an example whereby these international negotiations and international discussions on fisheries management as well as fishing opportunities may start to have an impact on how the objectives of the Act are delivered.
Elaine White.
Thank you very much. I think this potentially is a point where I see the ambition is maybe a concern. How I see the future being and how potentially policy might work out is different. We have been included as an inshore organisation in the international negotiation core groups this year, which has been very helpful, but also very distant in a way, because it seems that the issues of the inshore are maybe quite far away. I mean, we had talked about potentially having access to quota, about potentially looking at stocks that we wouldn't have normally been able to fish to allow local communities to diversify. My major concern through these discussions has been the fact that we're looking at potentially giving out new additional quota and not looking at how we redistribute the quota that we do have at the moment. There's a lot of talk about lack of access to third countries, and so having maybe the larger fleets have to pick up quota opportunities. And that's led to a lot of swaps from potentially inshore communities to allow that to happen. Now, I am very supportive of all sustainable fishing, regardless of the scale of which it happens at. But I do think there needs to be an understanding that there's probably still a massive disconnect between what the opportunities are for the smaller fleets to potentially be more resilient and more less of a monospecies, because they aren't really in that discussion. There is a priority in making sure that the boats that we have at the moment stay at sea. And I think we have to be looking at how we, potentially with the squeeze on inshore communities, we need to look at how we can make it sustainable for them as well. And that's what I would like to see in the ambition, to really include these new communities and new partners in a way that's sensible. Thank you.
Thanks, Elaine. Have you any follow-up, Alistair?
No, thank you, Camilla.
Thank you. A brief supplementary from Rachel Hamilton.
Can I follow up with Elspeth MacDonald, please, on what you said? On the TAC, the UK advocates a science and evidence-based approach on managing those stocks. What is the reality of that? And do you believe that approach is fair and balanced in those quota exchanges?
I think back to a point I made earlier about complexity and recognising that whilst we know some things, we don't know everything. There's lots of things that we don't know, and there's a lot of uncertainty around some of the things that we do know. I'm sounding a bit Rumsfeld here. But if we think about the situation with North Sea Cod, for example, science is telling us something, telling us that the distribution of cod in the North Sea is very different from what it was 20 or 30 years ago. It's telling us that there don't appear to be very many cod in the southern North Sea, but they still appear to be quite numerous in the northern North Sea. So that's what some of what the data collection tells us. But then we have models that are then used to make predictions and to provide fisheries catch advice about these stocks. And what these models don't necessarily do is take into account what is likely to have changed. So, for example, we think that it is widely thought, not just industry think, but there is a general view that many of our fish species are shifting northwards as a consequence of warming seas. I think Elaine mentioned this, climate change driven. But the scientific modelling is not keeping pace, or is not reflecting what are perhaps quite fast-moving changes in our environment. So, yes, science and evidence should underpin decision-making, but we have to recognise where that science and evidence actually might be lacking, or is out of date, or needs to be improved. And I think that's actually a point that I think I've made in my comments on the Joint Fisheries Statement. There are many references to science throughout the draft GFS, but I think they're quite inconsistent. It talks in places about best available science. It talks, and that best available science might not actually be very good. So making decisions on something that is perhaps quite poor science, because it's either out of date or it's not particularly comprehensive. I think we have to recognise that the best available science at times might not actually be very good. And there are, in some places in the document, there's ambition talking about being world class on science and world leading. And then in other places, we talk about, well, we might not have good enough science, so you know, we'll just have to make decisions based on where there may be data gaps. So science is really important in all of this, but it's also really important that we understand the limitations of it, and where actually it might not be very good. And I think industry would be very keen to be working with governments about how that fishery science can be improved, and would be very keen, I think, to have some constructive and I think quite ambitious discussions about what might be possible on the scientific front, so that we can make better decisions.
Thanks, Elspeth. A very brief supplementary from Ariane.
Thanks, Convener. Elspeth, I just wanted to continue on that that theme of the science piece. So last week, the Cabinet Secretary announced the consultation on remote electronic monitoring with cameras to gather data and feed it into decision-making and policy setting. I would love to hear from you your thoughts on the remote electronic monitoring, and you know, is that something, you know, they talked about rolling it out, and I know it's still in a consultation stage, but just to hear your initial thoughts on the on that in terms of giving you the science, your organisation, your members the science they need, and the government the science they need to make better decisions.
I think it's important that we make the distinction and understand the distinction between, in terms of what data and information might be being gathered for. So if REM is being used in the context of assurance and compliance, then I think we have to see that as distinct from data gathering for scientific purposes. I think what we have to be very clear about is what is the purpose of the data that would be being gathered through the proposals around REM. Of course, we'll be looking very carefully at that consultation and responding to that consultation. But I think it's really important that we don't conflate the issues between monitoring and compliance and assurance and scientific data gathering. I think there's much more that we need to do in terms of work that we could do with developing government and industry surveys, for example. There's been lots of things that we've tried to develop with government, and we'd be very keen to have those discussions. But I think we have to, say, make that clear distinction between compliance and that clear distinction around data gathering for scientific purposes.
Thanks, Elspeth. Can I move on to questions now from Jenny?
Thank you, Convener. Aline White, in her introduction, mentioned that there are different resources across the different inshore fishery areas, and also that really regional areas differ across Scotland. And then in her last answer, Elaine, you talked about you know, the need for communities to be able to diversify their catch. So I'm just wondering if you could expand a bit on that, where you would like to see the JFS, how it provides opportunities to that, and perhaps if Charles Miller has got any thoughts on that as well. Thank you.
I'm not sure that the JFS can pin it down. I mean, as I said at the beginning of the statement, I think this is an overarching strategy document. So I think where we're going to pin those issues down is at the devolved level and at local management levels. So, I mean, I'm talking about, we talked about if we're moving to different types of boats potentially in the future, would we be looking to have the same catch? Now, we can't potentially go to a lot of stocks because we don't have access to that quota. And I think it's about international negotiations, potentially people understanding that there may be a will to actually diversify. Because I think, and this is no criticism, because as I said, we've been very much involved in the negotiations, but we're very much the new kid on the block. And I think the priority has been keeping, you know, some of the larger boats going that are very used to international negotiations. And I think it's about making sure that we make the case that those communities round the coast need to have some way in, and because they're not fishing something, that doesn't mean that they don't want to, and that we may have science in the future that's reflexive enough to say, well, you know, you can move from potentially a monofilet to a different opportunity that may put less stress on the stocks. I think it's just bringing that home, and what we have at the moment is the fact that no quota will be distributed, but no quota, we don't know what that will be in a year-to-year basis, and it might be a stock that nobody would want to fish in the inshore. So it's how we can be flexible enough to meet those flexible needs, and I think that can happen domestically rather than just through the GFS. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Elaine. And Charles Miller?
Yeah, thank you. I think there's a really important issue here around how Section 25 of the UK Fisheries Act is integrated into all of this. That's essentially the aspect of the Act which relates to the distribution of fishing opportunities. And And I think it's really important that we don't lose sight of this, and that the JFS kind of brings this out. And there's a lot of criteria which it establishes around environmental performance, you know, impact of fishing on the environment, the history of compliance with regulatory requirements related to fishing, those sort of things. But there is also an important one here about the contribution of fishing to the local economy. And I think that's quite an important factor in determining how the fishing opportunities will be allocated around the coast. And so it's tying it into this wider concept of the community and coastal benefits. So, it's not just simply a question of track record. And I think that's a really important point that needs to be borne in mind.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Could we move on to the questions from Rachel Hamilton? Can we move on to question 10, please?
Yeah, thank you. The Joint Fisheries Statement says that FPAs are committed to further developing inclusivity and involvement. And I just wanted to get the views of the panel whether they believe that currently co-management does exist, and do they believe that within this framework future policy should be co-designed in a better way? And can I get some examples of how it works and how it doesn't work? And can I start possibly with Elspeth again, please?
Thank you. It's an interesting question and a good question. I think we have engagement currently in Scotland. We have stakeholder engagement. We have consultation. We have quite a lot of discussion, but I don't think that's always translates into what we would call co-management. And I think there is an opportunity now, looking at the way in which we can do things differently here in Scotland and in other parts of the UK, to really think about, you know, how we engage the right people in discussions around how we design our fisheries management going forward. And I think inclusivity and involvement is a very positive aspiration, but I think it's really important that it involves and includes the right people who've got the necessary understanding and knowledge to become involved in co-designing and co-managing things. So you don't want to be in a position where you have such a broad church, perhaps, and perhaps with some people in that church who perhaps don't necessarily have them all the necessary knowledge and understanding to design effective fisheries management and how we go forward. But you absolutely want to have the right people from whatever parts of the that church that do have the relevant knowledge and information and can be part of that sort of co-design process. So I think what we have at the moment is forums for engagement and discussion and consultation, but they don't really feel genuinely like co-designing and co-management. I think there's much more that we can do there, but it's important that we have the right knowledge and input into that process.
Elspeth, are there any examples across the globe of good co-management?
There may be. I don't know that I have any immediately. And I think from discussions with colleagues that have worked in New Zealand, I think they've been able to pioneer fisheries management plans in ways that I think have been successful. I think there's been some good examples there, and I think that some of the early thinking around fisheries management plans is I think drawing on some of these examples. There was a workshop that was held a couple of years ago. It was before I was involved in this role, that actually was bringing together best practice on fisheries management plans from other parts of the world to start to help the UK see how we might do this. So yes, I think there are examples from elsewhere, and I think it is recognised that the UK and Scotland can learn from these and that we should do that.
Can I bring in Helen, please? How can we improve our co-designing to ensure that we have a good approach to future of fishing policy?
Thanks. I mean, I would kind of largely agree with Elspeth at the minute in terms of where we are here in Scotland, but the situation is different across the four nations of the UK. And I would say Scotland is some way ahead of the other fisheries administrations by virtue of the fact that they do have regular connections with key stakeholders, which is good. But as Elspeth said, whether that actually equates to co-management at this point in time, I think is maybe not quite the case. And certainly from my experience of working with colleagues around the world, yes, there are examples of co-management from elsewhere, but depending on the scale that you know of your ambition and your geography and your fishery, you know, it can be quite a capacity intense process. You know, if you're talking about people from quite sort of far-flung parts of a country coming together. I mean, obviously, over recent years, you know, we've improved our ability to connect remotely, and I think that's been really helpful. But often that face-to-face connection, getting a few key people, as Elspeth says, people who actually understand the sort of bigger political context of the fishery, as well as the nuts and bolts of what actually happens on the water. I think they're both important to bring together, and getting a few people in a room to have that kind of understanding of who we're talking to, you know, because that really, you know, different people will bring different things to the table, and they may have amazing experiences of, you know, oh, situations from the US or you know, parts of Asia where we've had, you know, amazing co-management on quite small scale, but can it be scaled up? So it really depends on the level that you want to look at for co-management, and then really kind of trying to do a good job on getting those right people in the room and managing the process effectively. But I would say it's absolutely a good ambition, but it is one that needs adequately resourced and supported to make it happen properly. And I think a good example of that is probably in the United States, where they have regional bycatch response teams for each of the sort of regions of the US. But you know, it means you've got the compliance people, you've got the guys who are fishing, you've got people who are looking at, you know, the scientists who are underpinning the data, the policymakers. So it's, you know, it's quite a group of people, and it is quite a commitment.
We're under a bit of time pressure, but I wanted to really pick up as well on the how we monitor the effectiveness of that decision making, and I wondered if Professor Harrison had any views on that particular point.
And lots of views on your previous question, but less on that one, I have to say. I mean,
well, answer the first question, please. Do.
Okay, there's no perfect model of co-management. I think, you know, every country has it. Slightly different industry, slightly different stakeholders. So I don't think we can just lift and paste a model from another country. I think it's time we looked at co-management again in Scotland. We've got our regional inshore fisheries groups. They've been operating in current form since about 2016. They, you know, I think there's room to look at them. They provide a good voice for the fishing industry, less room for other stakeholders to come on board. And I think it's important that we don't operate in silo, that fisheries policy is developed with all relevant voices around the table. And I think it's definitely time for a review of our co-management arrangements in Scotland. Shetland is often held up as an interesting example, the regulating board, as you know, one model for very much a co-management industry-led initiative. But again, not without recent criticisms of that. So I think we need to look at this carefully, and fisheries management plans are going to be a good test of how we go forward in terms of involving all relevant stakeholders, industry and others. Future catching policy flags that the FMAC group that Scottish Government has is going to be key to implementing any future catching policy. So, you know, this is quite a priority, I think, moving forward, how we get this right.
Thank you. To move on, we are under a bit of time pressure, and just to be clear for members that we'll take questions next from Karen, followed by Alistair, and then from Edward. So, Karen, your question, please.
Yep, thank you. So we've been hearing how, in comparison, there are some differences in regards to how the four nations are planned, and I think I heard the word a lack of continuity. Was that Professor Harrison? Perhaps, please correct me if I'm wrong there. But isn't being individually sensitive to our coast an important aspect, particularly for inshore fishing, which is extremely bespoke to each area? I mean, what specific aspects of the other nation approaches would you want to see implemented in Scottish waters for that continuity, and why? And can I start with Professor Harrison, please?
I think I talk about consistency and coherence. I think, you know, this is a common framework. Fisheries are a shared resource. Many of the stocks, you know, straddle the boundaries of the four fisheries administrations. So there is a need for coherent decision-making. Equally, as I said in my opening statement, there is a need for some flexibility. There does need to be space for different fisheries administrations to pursue policies in particular areas. And I think inshore local stocks is one area where, of course, this statement shouldn't constrain innovation, the sort that Elaine White was talking about earlier. So there's a balance to be struck. Discards was the example I gave earlier. I think that more consistency is probably needed when we approach discards. I think there are challenges of having four completely separate regulatory frameworks for discards in the UK. But, you know, I think that's just a conversation that needs to be thought through.
Thank you. Can I ask Elaine, please?
Could I'm not sure. We didn't catch what you said there. Sorry, Karen.
I was moving on to Elaine to ask the question. Thank you.
Karen, could I jump in there, please? Because I think Elspeth's time's short. So if we could have Elspeth first and then Elaine.
Okay. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I'm afraid I do need to leave it at 10 past 10. So thank you for giving me the floor in the meantime. I think there was an example of this came up yesterday in another meeting where we were actually discussing the joint fishery statement with officials. And I had raised the issue of displacement of fishing by other marine activities. This gets a very short billing in the joint fisheries statement. I think there's only a few lines about it, but it's actually a really big issue for the fishing industry as we see the expansion of offshore wind, for example, the designation of highly protected marine areas, essentially other initiatives, other policies, other industries at sea, and the displacement effect this could have on fishing. And I queried why there was really so little in the joint fisheries statement addressing that. And the answer was, well, you know, these are issues that the four administrations will want to think about separately in their own waters. They might have different ways in how they deal with displacement. They might have different policies for how they achieve this. So I think I agree to an extent with the comments made by other panellists here. There is a balance to be struck between where it is sensible for there to be some alignment, but where there is where it's important and there is merit indeed in there being divergence because the situations are different. So there isn't a one-size-fits-all answer to this, I think. It is about how you find that sort of sweet spot between having sufficient flexibility to recognise and allow the administrations to deal with situations that are different, but not necessarily having difference just for the sake of it.
Okay, thank you. And just a very quick suck to you on that, Elspeth, before you have to go. In regards to the science aspect on that, I mean, is there any parts of the science from the other nations that you would like to see included? How does our science compare with the other nations?
I think when you look at Scotland in the context of fishing and fisheries, Scotland accounts for around about 60% of the UK total in terms of landings, both in terms of tonnage and value. So Scotland is, in numbers terms, the biggest part of the UK when it comes to fishing. So I don't have numbers and statistics to hand, but I would expect that in that context, Scotland probably punches a bit above its weight in comparison to, certainly in relation to Wales and Northern Ireland, in relation to fishery science. I know that there's good cooperation and collaboration between the science effort and in the administrations. There's good join up and cooperation between Marine Scotland Science in Scotland and CFAS Science south of the border. So I think, again, bearing in mind that we know that resources for science are going to be challenged, across the public sector budgets are going to be challenged in the years ahead, I think it's important, therefore, that we do have these sorts of frameworks that this joint fisheries statement is part of, that allows the administrations actually to think about how do we make the best use of the resources that we've got available for science. Let's make sure we're not duplicating effort. Let's make sure that we're actually using those resources wisely, getting the best bangs for our buck that we can, and doing that in ways that it reflects the domestic priorities of each of the administrations. So I think that's where the framework could be useful in helping us achieve that sort of balance.
That's great, thank you.
And Helen McLachlan, I think, wants to come in.
Oh, great.
Yeah, thanks. It was just a quick one, really, in terms of an example of where you would like to see some consistency of approach. So, for example, the mention of remote electronic monitoring with cameras, if the four administrations were to move forward with that, you would want to see a similar system rolled out so that, you know, vessels who are operating further offshore and crossing boundaries, you know, they wouldn't have multiple systems to have to deal with. So that's just one small example. But I think to James's point also, the fact that we've got, if we have common targets, goals, time-bound objectives even, the different administrations will take different timeframes probably in order to get there, or there will be different mechanisms. But as long as they have that shared objective, that's the key and the shared ambition.
And Elaine White, please.
Thank you very much. You talked about other examples. Just touching on cod, when we were in Norway about 4 or 5 years ago, I asked about how they managed to work with the local fishermen, because each of the local fishermen there were taking citizen science type thing. They were working as a reference sweep with the government, and they could actually tell the government, actually, there's a spawning happening in this fjord, and it would be closed down for a few weeks and reopened again. And this varied from fjord to fjord. So if we're talking about reflexiveness, about how we can help with communication and how we can help management, I do think you're right. We need to have divergence actually between the devolved nations, but also between the regions within Scotland. And I think we need to make a far better link between the fleets that we have there, who are basically floating science stations and who want to get involved, and actually our government. And I also think it's really important that we're asking the right questions. I think before we need baseline before we go into various different kind of narrow questions about what's out there, because the baseline will lead to that. I also think that we have to be tied up and joined up in terms of our governmental resources, because as I mentioned before, we have different organisations. We have Marine Scotland Fisheries, we have Nature Scot. They're all doing different science projects and dedicating different types of resources to the same types of things, or coming at it from slightly different angles. The joined up point about that is really essential, and we need to start getting that figured out. And also, I would mention capacity. What we need to acknowledge is that each of the different regions has a different capacity with its fishermen. You might have a very small fleet, you might have a very large fleet. That's important. But also in terms of the other stakeholders in the area. So you may have an area that has a lot of very active lobby community group type things that are pulling down maybe potentially millions of funds a year, but that's maybe not happening in another area. So what you might find is that one area could be under a lot of pressure in terms of how they engage and with the questions that they're reactive to than another one. So I think for me, engagement is important, but the balance is right. And I also think, sorry, just to go, I think it's really important that we understand what each mechanism is for. Because what I certainly see is we're talking about a strategic mechanism here, we're talking about a strategic overarching thing here, and we're talking about pinning a lot of detail to it. I see this happening in a lot of forums. I see that Marine Scotland have public consultations so that everyone can apply, whether you're working in ASDA, whether you're a fisherman, you can reply to that. They have FMACs, they have FMACs, and they have IFGs. So there's an opportunity for just about all of the stakeholders to engage in one of those appropriate things. But what I see quite a lot of the time is everyone coming with their own interests. So, for instance, maybe potentially coming to a marine planning partnership and wanting to look at solely fisheries management. And I think we need to start understanding, and that's for all of the engaged parties to understand actually what the purpose of the framework we're engaging is about. Because we all have our own aspirations, but we don't want to drive it too far away from what it is. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Elaine. Can I move on to questions from Alistair Allen, please?
Thank you, Convener. The regional inshore fisheries groups, as we've touched on, I think, play an important part in developing fisheries management plans under the GFS. But do you see that role changing in future, and how might it change, or how might it be supported in future? So I don't know, that might be a question initially for Helen McLaughlin.
Thanks. I think there's a lack of detail, really, in terms of the fisheries management plans and quite how they're going to be sort of developed. And I think that's one of our concerns, because they were heralded certainly as a key tool with which we would start to look at restoring docks and looking at that wider ecosystem-based management. And there's not an awful lot, there's not a great sense of how that is actually going to be taken forward. So I think that's something that we'll have to come back to be honest. But we're very, in our response, we've certainly set out some of the things that we'd like to see those fisheries management plans addressing.
And Charles, I don't know if you want to come in on that.
Yes, thank you. I think the RIFGs have been charged already with producing fisheries management plans. Excuse me. And there's been quite a range, we say, in the kind of bent and content of those plans. And that's caused us considerable concern, not least because the RIFGs are good at representing the fishing industry, but they're not a multi-stakeholder forum. They don't provide an opportunity for different stakeholders to contribute to the whole management of the fishery under an ecosystem-based management approach, which takes into account all the different human interactions as well as multiple species, both target species and non-species. So there are significant shortcomings in some of the RIFG fisheries management plans. So we welcome that JFS is clear importance it attaches to fisheries management plans. But we actually, whilst on this subject, we do have concerns about what appear to have been proposed within the Scottish area. There seems to be some significant gaps why there is no scallop fisheries management plan. This surely ticks the criteria of economic value, of socioeconomic importance and ecosystem significance. So there are some really significant questions there around why certain fisheries management plans in Scotland have been proposed. And we would be really interested in trying to drill down into that. There's another aspect of that, and again, it relates to the ecosystem-based approach, which is obviously, that's the third objective of the Act and in the JFS. And that's managing species in isolation is counterintuitive almost to the ecosystem-based approach. And Scotland's proposed fisheries management plans are single species, exclusively. Whereas if you look to some of the fisheries management plans in the other regions, they cover the whole kind of range of demersal species, which is a much more coherent approach. So that we have, to sort of come back to your question, the RIFGs have done something. We think there's a lot of scope for doing more around FMPs and getting them right. But actually, the direction of travel, as indicated in the JFS, Scotland is a cause for concern.
Thank you.
Now moving on now to questions from Edward Mountain, please.
Sorry, I've got a follow-on to that question, yeah. If I may. Is 2016, the Scottish Government announced that they wanted to produce an inshore fisheries bill, and the rationale put behind it was that they didn't feel that they understood or had control of the inshore fisheries like they should have. And part of that was to include management plans on a zonal basis, as far as I understand it. It never came about. Do you think that was a missed opportunity? And because of the shortness of time, I'm very happy to take a yes or no answer, if you're prepared to do that, from Charles Miller and Elaine White, if I may, please.
Yes, it was a missed opportunity. Hope the opportunity will come around again.
Yes, but I think there's opportunities to potentially do it through the framework that we have as well. There's definitely scope for improvements.
OK, and just to follow up on that, do you think we need greater regulation of the inshore fisheries on the basis that we don't fully understand who's taking what, where, when and how?
I'd certainly, from CIF's point of view, that there's considerable scope for further regulation of that, and indeed of the science too. I mean, you know, there's no stock assessments done on the wrasse fishery or the scallop fishery. There is a lot more that could be done on the inshore, and the inshore is 70% of the fleet.
Thank you, Convener. Elaine, sorry.
I think if you actually look at some of the discussions of the IFGs, I think you'll see that fishermen are suggesting better regulation. And just in touch upon Charles' point, he said that there was no scallop plans. There are regional scallop plans. These things are being discussed with the IFGs. In terms of how much resource there is to take them forward, I think that might be an issue that we can talk about at another time.
Edward, did you have your main question?
Yes. My next question really is on spatial planning, and in some ways it's a pity that Elspeth has left us. But one of the conflicts we see is across the resource. Everyone wants to use a bit of it, whether it's wind farms, whether it's aquaculture, whether it's dredgers, whether it's scallop fishermen or diving. I mean, how do we do? Some sort of regulations so that we ensure that everyone gets to use the resource and are good neighbours to the other people who also want to use the resource. I mean, James, do you want to head off on that? And then perhaps everyone, if they just give a quick response to that. James?
I can certainly start. And I think, you know, it's important we understand the Joint Fisheries Statement and the Fisheries Act as being part of a much bigger puzzle of marine governance that sits alongside the Marine Spatial Planning System under the Marine Scotland Act. 2010. We have a National Marine Plan, which in a sense is partly about dealing with this. It's due for review. We're waiting to see whether the Scottish Government are going to actually review it. And I think there's a strong argument, given the debates about displacement, given these new developments, given the post-Brexit scenario, that we need a new National Marine Plan. We also need more regional marine plans. You know, it's been so slow rolling out regional marine plans, and that's where you could potentially get into much more detailed spatial planning. But at the moment, the approach that's been taken is really not very spatial. And I think, you know, I have a lot of sympathy for the fishing industry and the comments of Elspeth earlier, that they are being pushed aside. We're asking lots of questions about where do we put wind farms? Where do we put MPAs? They're important questions. But we also need to be asking which areas of the sea do we prioritise for fisheries? Because at the moment they are being left with the scraps that other policy areas, other sectors are not taking up. And I think regional marine planning is the forum for actually having those conversations about where we put different activities and making sure each activity is given the value that it deserves.
Helen, do you want to come in on that? And I think that there's got to be a space for nature in there somewhere as well. Helen?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, over the last sort of 20-odd years, we have identified areas that are important for features, habitats and species in our marine environment, and we've designated those as protected areas. But very, very few of them have actually had measures put in place to end what has been identified as destructive activities in those. And fishing you know, is one of those activities often cited as a problem for particularly benthic species and habitats. And so, you know, one of the things in terms of looking at going forward, we need to sort that out. Let's protect some of those key spaces for nature. But then importantly, I mean, as has been said by other panellists, the, you know, that big national discussion about how do we use our seas for the environment, for the social benefits of this nation, you know, how do we use it to address the nature and climate targets that we need to meet? And how do we do that with the greatest levels of ambition and urgency possible? But there is definitely the need for those conversations, because offshore wind and other renewables are, you know, are not going away. They're coming down the track. But we also want to see a vibrant and thriving fishing industry. So how do we make that, you know, that balance off? But there has to be, as you say, space for nature is absolutely vital, because we are failing consistently to meet good environmental status across our marine indicators. 11 out of 15 of them are not green, and that is a failure. And that's why this, you know, the policies we're talking about here today are really vital to get right to make that step change.
Charles.
And also Lord Ward just heard. You know, spatial management is clearly important. As we heard a moment ago, regional marine planning is an obvious route to take it forwards. But I think, you know, and so I concur with that. I think what's important is that we remember that spatial management doesn't, you know, it's not quite as simple as just designating an area to a certain activity and thinking that area that activity is going to suffer by not being in it. What matters to the fishing industry is how many fish there are to catch, actually, not the number of square kilometres that their boats can move over. So if you have a smaller area where fishing can take place, but there is a greater number of fish within it, then that is a win for the fishing industry. And this seems to be an issue which Marine Scotland seems to move very slowly on, should we say. Other nations recognise that if you actually create areas which are under a spatial management regime where there is spawning and there is an opportunity for fish stocks to increase, albeit you have a smaller area where the fishing industry can operate, but you actually also have a richer fishing industry. And so I think some of these complexities need to be looked at, and through multi-stakeholder engagement opportunities, that's the way to go forward, and this regional marine planning being the key one.
And I think Elaine's the last one, or is Elaine given? Did I miss it?
No, I'm happy to talk. Yes, I think this is really important, and I think what the point that James made is very important. We need to start being less reactive and more proactive about how we plan where fishing can happen, because he is right, we are being left. Fishing can't happen everywhere. It can only happen because you have access to 70% of the area. Maybe only 30% of that is helpful to some fishermen, depending on what species that you're going for. Now, on an average day, I don't know how everyone else is, but I get 60 to 100 emails a day, minimum. And that is usually from future aquaculture sites for seaweed, finfish aquaculture sites, new renewable sites. It's always a different industry. I would say probably about 70 to 80% of my work is looking, reacting to different industry requirements, whether it's laying cables, etc. How much space that actually leaves you in a day to look at how you develop your fishery is then it's negligible. So I think the future of fisheries management strategy is important, but I think what we actually need is a map, taking in local fisher knowledge of where fishing happens. And there needs to be not a fair balance of decision, because I do feel that there's quite a lot of priority given to the onus is on us to object to everything. And, you know, if it's affecting us and provide the socioeconomic information and provide the data, I think we need to be looking at that process, because if we're doing that so many times a day, what we're not doing is effectively planning.
Thank you, Elaine. Thank you, Camina.
Thank you, Elaine. I think we've run out of time, I'm afraid. Thank you to the witnesses for their evidence. As always, we're time pressured and we could discuss this for a lot longer. But we'll suspend the meeting now for a comfort break and for a change in witnesses, and reconvene at 10:30. We now move to our second evidence session, and I welcome to the meeting Marie Goujon, Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands, and Scottish Government officials Alan Gibb, Acting Deputy Director, and Paul McCarthy, Policy Manager for Funding and Strategy, Sea Fisheries Division in Marine Scotland. Before I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement, I'd like to remind members that the Parliament is observing the National Day of Reflection at 12 noon. I will therefore aim to conclude this session just before 12. Cabinet Secretary, opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the Committee for providing me the opportunity to discuss the Joint Fisheries Statement and the UK Fisheries Framework, which I would just like to briefly introduce today. So, together, these documents help explain how fisheries will be managed across the UK for future years in a way that allows the UK as a whole to share common goals on fisheries management and marine protection, whilst protecting the Scottish Government's devolved powers in these areas in deciding how those goals should be approached and how policy should be implemented. The future of fisheries management strategy and the future catching policy, along with the blue economy strategy to be launched this spring, set out how I intend to make Scotland a world-class fisheries manager, focusing on the issues of importance and relevance to Scottish waters and Scottish communities. These documents show how the commitment to achieving sustainable management of fisheries is locked into our overarching fisheries management strategy and will drive many new policies. In this context, the GFS and framework help establish the high-level UK policy and how the UK administrations will work together, ensuring that devolution is respected, while at the same time identifying where we need to work together to deliver sustainable management of our seas. With the high-level goals established at the UK level through the GFS and framework, how we implement them will be taken forward through the actions of the Scottish Government in order to achieve our goals on marine protection, recovering biodiversity, net zero and growing the blue economy. The documents are split as the Joint Fisheries Statement predates the UK frameworks process, but broadly speaking, the GFS sets out the policies, the joint policies, the four UK administrations will pursue, with the framework setting out how the administrations will work together. In relation to the Joint Fisheries Statement, as set out in the Fisheries Act 2020, the GFS sets out the policies of the administrations to achieve the eight policy objectives. The GFS sets out how the objectives in the Fisheries Act have been interpreted and how the administrations aim to deliver a vibrant, profitable and sustainable fishing industry supported by a healthy marine environment. The policies cover the sea fisheries policy and management within UK waters and in negotiations with other coastal states. They cover fisheries science, fisheries management, determination and the apportionment of fishing opportunities, access to UK waters, bycatch, illegal, unreported and unregulated fishing, marine protected areas, climate change and a number of other areas. In order to protect devolved competence, these policies are set at a high level with the detail to be delivered by the Scottish Government. This will enable the Scottish Government to ensure that policy is tailored to Scottish waters and Scottish circumstances, whilst also achieving high-level goals. The GFS also sets out our approach on fisheries management plans. The Government will take the lead in drafting FMPs for many of the stocks of greatest interest to us, including the pelagic and demersal stocks. The UK Fisheries Management and Support Framework is a more operationally focused document which, broadly speaking, addresses how the administrations should engage with each other and establishes groups and processes by which we will regulate the day-to-day business. The structure of the Memorandum of Understanding consists of one high-level agreement covering common principles regarding working together, dispute avoidance and resolution, and data collection and sharing. And underneath this MOU sit the more detailed operational agreements detailing how exactly the administrations will work together on a number of other areas. This approach allows administrations to approach each issue independently, allowing, for example, changes to quota management without needing to reopen the entire MOU. And the ability to take issues singly should also allow for considerable flexibility in terms of deciding when and how we wish to amend any part of the MOU or any of its annexed agreements. Together, these documents help explain how fisheries will be managed across the UK for future years in a way that allows the UK as a whole to share common goals on fisheries management and marine protection, whilst protecting the Scottish Government's devolved powers in these areas and deciding how those goals should be approached and how policy should be implemented. So I hope that's been helpful to set that out, and I'm happy to take any questions from the committee.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can we have questions from members now, starting with Alistair Allen?
Thank you, Convener. I wonder, on the back of the statement you just made there, whether you could say anything about what the process of developing the joint fisheries statement has been like from a Scottish Government point of view, and whether it says anything more generally about the relationship between the four administrations, but also whether it's a process you feel could be changed or improved in the future.
I think what the process has shown so far in developing this, I think it shows how effectively the four administrations across the UK can work together. And I think it also shows, importantly, the alignment that we have in terms of the high-level goals and ambitions that have been set out in the JFS itself. I think that it also shows that, you know, this is how devolution should work. I mean, obviously, that's been a key consideration. We want to make sure that devolved powers are respected and adhered to. And I think the agreement that we have set out, the joint fisheries statement, as well as the framework, identify that, and it sets out those high-level ambitions while allowing us the flexibility to determine the individual policies which are right for our own industry and sector here. So again, I think it's been a positive piece of work, and of course we'll continue to see how that develops, but I think on these issues, again, it shows how we're ultimately aligned in the ultimate objectives that we would like to see. Now, that's not to say that it's always been the case, and that we will always agree on every element. And I think one example of that, where we have seen disagreement and which we've also raised in discussions with the committee previously, is in relation to the UK Seafood Fund, which obviously cuts across devolved competence and spends in an area which is entirely devolved, which is something which has caused confusion for the industry. It's spending in areas that we're already looking to fund ourselves in Scotland. So again, while there are areas and specific issues that we have, I think it does show how we can work together positively and effectively.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I wonder, Cabinet Secretary, if you could respond to a previous witness's comments about the level of ambition set out in the draft joint fisheries statement.
I think that what's set out in the level of ambition that we've set out in the GFS is a really high level of ambition, because it shows our ambitions for our fishing industry, for our marine environment. We want to see a profitable industry, and we want to have a healthy marine environment as part of that too. So I think it is really world leading in terms of the ambition that it sets out. I know that there have been concerns from various stakeholders about the specific detail that they don't see as being included within the joint fisheries statement, but as I hope I've been able to respond to, and what I talked about in my opening statement and in response to the previous question, is that it's very important that we do have those overall high level ambitions that we look to achieve and that we're aligned on those, but it's also vitally important that it's up to each administration to determine how those policy objectives will be achieved and to set that out, and that it respects devolution in that sense. So the committee, I know, will be aware, of course, of the statement that I made to Parliament last week, which I think is a good example of that, where we set out what we intend to do in relation to our future catching policy, as well as remote electronic monitoring, to policies which are currently out to consultation at the moment. So I think that shows, you know, how we are actively delivering on the ambitions that have been set out in the GFS, and how we intend to deliver that through the strategies and the policies that we've set out, and we will continue to do so.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions from Jim Fairley now?
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, could you maybe just outline the process for agreeing the interpretation of the fisheries objectives in the GFS between the UK Government and the devolved administrations, and were stakeholders involved in that process?
Yes, there was obviously discussions between the four administrations in setting this out, and of course I'm glad that we've been able to align in terms of the objectives and the policies that are set out in the GFS. Stakeholder engagement has, of course, been critical to that process as well. So there was a community of interest which set in the process of developing the GFS, which sought to gather stakeholder views from across the UK, keeping stakeholders involved throughout that process. But I don't know if either Paul or Alan would want to say a bit more about that process of stakeholder engagement.
Please, Paul, yeah.
Sorry, thank you. Just to say briefly, yes, there was a community of interest set up across the UK. The Scottish representatives on the community of interest was every stakeholder on our FMAC and IFMAC groups. So that covers most of the fishermen, scientists, NGOs and other interested parties. They were informed and engaged about the development of the drafting of the GFS. They were able to provide feedback, and of course they'll also be fully engaged in this full public consultation exercise that we're doing as well, which provides another forum for them to feedback views on. Thank you.
I have a question as to how you actually managed to keep them all thinking in the same way, but that's maybe a question for another day, convener.
Thank you. Mercedes, a supplementary from you.
Thanks. Yeah, I've got a couple of supplementaries about the fisheries objectives. So the national benefit objective is that fishing activities of UK fishing boats bring social or economic benefits to the United Kingdom or any part of the United Kingdom. So could you outline what measures the Scottish Government will take to achieve this objective?
I think I'd probably reflect on the examples that I'd provided earlier in relation to the future catching policy and REM as an example of that, where I think, you know, through the future catching policy, it sets out how we will meet not just the national benefit objective, but across the other objectives that are set out in the Fisheries Act too, because obviously it's critical that these are what's set out in legislation, and the delivery mechanisms that we use for our policies meet the objectives that are set out. So I'd say that the future catching policy is an example of that in meeting that objective.
Okay, thank you very much. So I understand that the economic link, which was announced in November last year, requires only 50% of catches made by Scottish boats to be landed in the UK. But this is less than the requirement for English counterparts. So can you confirm if you intend to match the English rules, or whether the Scottish rules are going to remain lower than the English ones?
I'd actually set out, I think it was in the debate that I'd in Parliament that took place last year, that we'll be looking to introduce new economic link measurements as of next year. And I'll be setting out as of the start of 2023. So I'll be setting out more detail on that in due course.
And do you expect them to match the English requirements?
It's not possible for me to say that at the moment, because as I say, that detail will be coming when I look to make that announcement.
Okay, thank you. And then one other question. So the Fisheries Act states that administrations must meet the bycatch objective, which includes that the catching of fish that are below minimum conservation reference size and other bycatch is avoided or reduced. There don't seem to be any plans for how this will be done in the Joint Fisheries Statement, but the future catching policy, which was published last week, states that in the case of undersized fish, we propose allowing discarding. So can you explain how these two positions are consistent with each other?
Yeah, I'm happy to. Now, the GFS wouldn't be setting out the detail on that delivery. As I say, it sets out the high-level policy ambitions, and then it's the policies that we'd be looking to introduce ourselves and the delivery mechanisms that will ultimately achieve the objectives that are set out in the Act. So you correctly refer to the future and catching policy, and I'd also mentioned in a previous response how that meets the other objectives. So in relation to the bycatch objective, the technical and spatial measures which we've set out as part of that consultation are what would help us deliver on the bycatch objective. But I mean, what I would say is that's out to consultation at the moment. So we've developed the proposals in consultation with our stakeholders and with industry, because of what's crucial for us is that we introduce a policy that will work and will be effective in tackling some of these issues. So again, that's out to consultation at the moment, and we'll of course consider any correspondence or that comes in as a result of that. But sorry, Paul, I don't know whether you were... Oh, sorry, Alan would like to come in on that point too.
Yeah, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Just to expand further, so the consultation document on the future catching policy is very explicit that the objective is to reduce or remove this unwanted bycatch, so to mitigate that issue altogether by greater selectivity and spatial, increasing mesh sizes and so forth. The part about allowing some that you can't avoid to be discarded, the key here is to make sure that it's accounted for. So it's part of the overall catches that's accounted for. And we're totally aligned with the current principles within the EU around here. So there are mechanisms to allow for that, whether the fish can survive being discarded, high survivability, whether there's de minimis, so that comes off the existing quota. or whether there's a disproportionate cost in forcing somebody to take in. So the example I use is a small trawler landing in the in Isla or Jura, for example, and it has basically a handful of fish, a bucket of fish catches that little. He would have to land that, store that, get transport onto a ferry, transport it to the mainland in West Loch Tarbert, then get it transported to somewhere else to be disposed of. That's a wholly disproportionate cost to impose on anybody, and it's for those examples that we would look to permit, as long as the fish were accounted for. And I think we give examples of a costing example in the actual consultation as well. Thank you.
So just to clarify, in terms of achieving how the government will achieve the bycatch objective, we need to wait until the consultation on the future catching policy is concluded?
Well, we would need to implement the policy which would deliver on that objective.
Okay, thank you.
A supplementary from Rachel.
It's just a quick supplementary on the point about recording and accounting for discard. I wondered, will you wait for stakeholders to feed into how practical that actually is?
Well, the proposals that we put forward for the consultation were developed through consultation with our stakeholders anyway, because, like I say, we want to make sure that if we implement this policy that we get it right. But, of course, that is going to involve discussion and through the consultation process, hearing the responses that come back as a result of that, so that we can help shape a policy which is going to deliver on the objectives.
So the potential to put a tolerance in there, if it is impractical, when you get that feedback. I mean, obviously, we have to wait for it.
Yeah, I mean, I do think what we've set out means that it will help tackle the issues that we've seen, and these are practical measures which we believe can be adhered to and will help us tackle some of these challenges. But, of course, we're in the middle of the consultation process right now, so we await further feedback on that.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, we heard from Professor Harrison in the last session of witness evidence about his concerns around the powers of the Secretary of State in determining fishing opportunities for the whole of the UK. Can you give us some clarification on what those powers are of the Secretary of State and the fishing opportunities for stocks exclusive within Scottish waters and how this will be dealt with in the draft GFS?
Yes, I mean, I believe that this was an area that was subject to a lot of discussion when it came to the legislative consent memorandum for the Fisheries Act. But the setting of the total allowable catch for the UK as a whole is something that is reserved to the Secretary of State. But there are, and that's the case for all stocks, I think, bar one, which is delegated. And the delegated tack, the key example of that would be Clyde Herring. And so essentially what would happen in that sense is the Scottish Government takes the lead on building the evidence for that and setting what the tax should be. And also, we would also consult with our stakeholders in relation to that, who would advise on the tax for the stock. And then that tax would be for the given to the Secretary of State for determination. But we wouldn't anticipate there. And as far as I'm aware, there haven't been any issues in that regard.
Okay, that was my next question. If the Scottish Parliament or Government are making the determination of what the tax should be, it is then put back to the Secretary of State and the UK Government, you would assume that decision that is made by yourselves would always be adhered to?
That would be adhered to, yes. It's more of an efficiency measure that's there at the moment. But again, I think that's what's important to remember about the framework that we have set out, that I think that if there were any potential issues, ultimately it's the memorandum of understanding that's set out in the framework as well as to how we would look to address any potential conflicts or issues, at what stage that would be dealt with too. But we don't anticipate that being an issue. And like I say, I think this was an area that had been subject to a lot of discussion around the time of the LCM being considered.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Questions now from Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. So continuing on the theme of fishing opportunities, the Community Inshore Fisheries Alliance called for a recognition that some coastal areas may wish to change and develop their current operations through diversification into new stocks or a changing of scale of fishing operations. So I'd like to ask whether you believe that the JFS should be more explicit about providing opportunities to inshore fleets to encourage that diversification and a transition to lower impact modes of fishing.
Again, I probably reflect on some of the comments that I made earlier about the overall, what the JFS is there to do and the overall framework and about the high level ambitions that have been set out in relation to that. So I don't think it would be appropriate to have those explicit provisions within the JFS, because I think it should be ultimately up to the fisheries administrations and authorities to determine how quota should be allocated and how those fishing opportunities should be allocated. And obviously we have to make sure that we adhere to what's in the Fisheries Act in relation to that too, which is set out in section 25 within that. So I think it's important that devolution is respected in that regard and that we have the flexibilities to consider that as individual administrations and authorities. And I think some of the issues that we could potentially arise if that was included within the JFS would mean that it's then could almost be subject to UK veto or other administrations then having an impact on how we allocate or distribute our own fishing opportunities. So I think it's important that we have that high-level vision, but that we have the powers and we're able to deliver what works best for our industry here and how we think that should be allocated and distributed.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. Edward Mountain, please.
Sorry, Camilla, you've wrong-footed me there. I wasn't sure that I was going to come in at that stage. But okay. Yeah, you're right, Convener. I apologise. I should have been paying greater attention. Very nice to see you, Cabinet Secretary. And my question really is the Scottish Government's role in international fishery. I've been interested to hear how you said to Jim Fairley that the Scottish Government would lead on some areas of fisheries management where the stocks were in their water. Would you see that when international negotiations were taking part, that they would also lead on that because they had the expertise, or would that be a question for the Secretary of State? What would you like to see, Cabinet Secretary, and what do you think will happen?
Well, we have a strong leading role at the moment in international negotiations, and I think I'll probably hand over to Alan in a second to provide more detail on that, given that he takes the lead in some of these and can provide more information in relation to that as well. But of course, I mean, given the size of the marine area that we have, I think it's only fair that we would have an important role in when it comes to international negotiations. And we are the joint heads of delegation when it comes to specific stocks as well. But again, I'll hand over to Alan on that point, who can provide more detail as to how that works.
Yeah, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So we actually have very, very good working relations with our UK counterparts here. So I recognise international discussions are reserved, but in all fairness to my DEFRA counterparts and officials, when it's stocks of significant importance to Scotland or dominant in Scottish waters, for example, we have a 98% share of the blue whiting and 93% of herring and 75% of mackerel. Our views are very dominant. Our views are routinely taken account of in terms of what we think the position should be, whether that's management or the quota setting. Now, we do this in a collective way, and I wouldn't say we agree 100% all of the time, but that's part of a negotiation as well. And we do manage to come to situations that we are content with in an overall package. Occasionally we might have to revert to the Cabinet Secretary to escalate an issue, and there'll be minister-to-minister discussions, but broadly speaking that's the exception, and it's good relations and Scotland's interests are well represented in those forums.
Thank you. It sounds like it all works very well and you all work very well together. Sounds perfect. Convener.
That's not, as I would touch on the point Alan says. I mean, there are occasionally issues we have to escalate, but in general, it works well.
I'm sure, Cabinet Secretary, you don't always agree with what Alan says, but, you know, that's life. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions from Rachel?
Cabinet Secretary, why hasn't the Scottish Government proposed development of fisheries management plans in the period after 2022?
Well, I hope you can see from the fisheries management plans that we've set out as part of the JFS that there are a number of plans within that, and we've tried to focus on the stocks that are of commercial interest to our industry in Scotland, and we wanted to make sure that we put our initial focus on the development of FMPs, where much of that detail is already known for those stocks too. Now, that's not to say that there wouldn't be any further iterations of fisheries management plans or there won't be any more beyond that point, but I think that we've put our initial focus in the right place. I know that there are the fisheries management plans that have been proposed by other administrations cover non-quota stocks, but of course we'll be monitoring and looking at how that work develops. But that is a far more complex piece of work. And again, I think that the initial focus we've put on that is the right one. I don't know whether Paul or Alan would perhaps want to elaborate on some of the potential issues with the focus on other areas.
I'll just speak briefly on this matter to say, as the Cabinet Secretary has outlined, we initially focused on the stocks of key commercial importance for Scotland, of which we have the most information. We note that other administrations are looking to take forward more complex, more challenging FMPs. We are looking to learn from their experience. We are also looking to consider how we wish to manage stocks going forward. We can revisit the list of FMPs at a future date if we decide that we wish to go and introduce FMPs for non-quota stocks. And I think I will just stop there, actually. The list is not set in stone. We can revisit it. We can review it in light of experience. Oh, that, the other point I want to say also is that the existence, the absence of a fisheries management plan does not prevent us from taking action to manage a fishery should we decide that such a thing needs to be done. We can act in the absence of an FMP or while we're waiting to draft such a thing. Thank you.
I just want to push you on this because the timescales proposed for the FMPs in Scotland are very short compared to the other fishing policies authorities, which are set over a six-year period. And that timescale coincides with the joint fisheries statement itself. So I just wondered why you hadn't got anything beyond 2022. I don't feel confident that you've answered the question sufficiently to understand why it isn't over that six-year period.
We'll also be discussing with other administrations and working jointly with them too on the development of FMPs. So again, well, I would say we haven't set out anything beyond that timescale. I mean, the timescales that are set out for us to develop the current FMPs that we've set out in the JFS will be very challenging to try and meet. But again, I would just come back to, I think it's important that we focus on the stocks that we've set out as a priority. That's not to say that there won't be other FMPs. They'll also be subject to review as well. But I think that that's where our focus needs to be, rather than setting out a definitive list of every single stock that we would look to consider and the timescales for that. I think it's important that we focus our work on those, the initial set that we've set out.
Yeah, I mean, just to pick up on your point there about the single species and the commercial element of that, I have got stakeholders who have contacted me with concern that some other species aren't included, such as wrasse and scallops and others. So I think it's important to note, and I hope that that will tease itself out during the consultation process itself. And it sounds as though you are aware that needs to be considered too.
Yeah, and that's where, I mean, we will be obviously closely monitoring the work that's happening with other administrations and the work that they're leading on in development of the FMPs for non-quota stocks. I mean, as I said, and as Paul was highlighting as well, that is going to be very complex. So again, I think it's important that we continue to monitor that work before we then set out what FMPs we might plan to take forward in that area.
A short supplementary from Mercedes.
Yeah, just on that point about the other administrations, the English and Welsh administrations have already agreed that a fisheries management plan should be developed for key fisheries like scallop, dredge fishery and the largely unregulated wrasse fisheries. So it sounds like you're not able to commit to those within the JFS. Is it something that you are looking at? Do you have an idea of when you'll be able to commit to establishing and delivering plans for these fisheries?
I can't set out a definitive timescale on that yet, purely for the reasons that I've outlined as well, and because some of those stocks that you've mentioned and the non-quota stocks is a very complex area. And also, we have quite a long list of FMPs that we're looking to deliver and develop on the specific stocks that we've set out within the JFA. So that's not to say that it won't ever happen, but I can't give you a definitive timescale for that work yet.
Alan, okay. Alan, give.
Thank you. Thank you. Just on that non-quota stock FMP point, I would just reiterate Paul's comment that that doesn't mean you can't manage, and actually we will be managing the scarlet fisheries and other non-quota stock fisheries. Wales and England have taken an approach. We've taken a different view around the complexity, and we need to learn. We'll see what they're doing. Obviously, we'll get feedback on the consultation. But there are a number of things there. There's no MSY proxies for some of these stocks. Some of these stocks are actually explicitly referenced in the Trade and Cooperation Agreement with the European Union. And that brings in a level of detail around allocation, shared access and so forth, that I think we in the Scottish Government think we need to work that through and understand that better rather than committing to something now. But it's something that we very much look to be doing in a management sense going forward, absolutely.
And a supplementary from Arianne Burgess?
No.
No? I misunderstood that.
I was saying that Alan
wanted
to speak.
All right, okay. Apologies, I misunderstood that. What role will regional inshore fisheries groups have in the development of FMPs under the JFS, and do they have the necessary capacity and resources?
I mean, in the development of the FMPs, they'll be subject to consultation, and we, of course, would look to develop these in through discussion with our stakeholders as well. So we obviously have a number of fora that we use and that we engage with, whether that's the FMAC, the IFMACs, the Regional Inshore Fisheries Groups too. So I imagine that they would be part of that process. And of course, we want to make sure that we work with our stakeholders in the production of these. And that's, of course, an integral part of that process.
And in terms of resources and capacity,
That's something that I have to keep under review or to look at. I mean, we do provide resources to regional inshore fisheries groups to enable them. I mean, the regional inshore fisheries groups, by their nature, bring together fisheries interests or people that haven't traditionally been represented by other organisations, because they are smaller businesses, and we've tried to develop those forums to enable them and to give them the capacity to engage. So. But of course, if there were any issues emerging there, then we of course look to monitor that. But again, I would hope that they would be playing a part in this process, as would our other stakeholders.
Okay. Jim Fairley, supplementary.
Thank you very much, Convener. I just want to, going on that, the engagement with the stakeholders and going back to the complexity of it, I would assume that the stakeholders will have a full understanding of the complexity, and they would be comfortable with the fact that you'd rather take your time to get a fisheries management plan right rather than quickly. Is that fair?
It's not as if we develop these things in isolation anyway and without any engagement, and we'd be looking to keep our various stakeholders informed throughout that process, and also so that they can help work with us. I don't think there's any point in developing policies or plans that fundamentally won't work or can't be implemented by the people who are responsible for that. So I think that engagement is critical. I mean, of course, we are ambitious, and we want to make sure that we deliver on the objectives that have been set out in the Act and in setting out the policies that will ultimately deliver on those. But of course, we do also want to make sure that we do get that right, that we take the right amount of time to make sure we have that engagement and to make sure that we're ultimately delivering the right policies.
So the speed of the plan is less important than the ability of the plan to do its job?
Well, of course, that's something you've got to manage. I mean, we have, as I've said, it's a really challenging timescale that's been set out for the FMPs that are in the JFS at the moment. I do think those timescales are important as in trying to meet that and in setting that out, because that's what's been set out in the legislation too. So, but of course, we want to make sure that when we're creating the FMPs that we are getting that right, that it's not rushed and we're able to undertake that work in the way that we would wish to do.
Okay, thank you.
A couple of supplementaries from one from Edward Mount and then Mercedes Villalba.
Thank you, Convener. The, I think the whole of the previous panel, except for Elspeth MacDonald, who'd already left, lamented the loss of the inshore fisheries bill that the government announced they were going to bring forward in 2016, and all said it would be helpful to use that bill as a vehicle to come up with inshore fisheries management plans. Do you agree, and will you bring it forward?
I don't particularly see the need at the moment to bring forward a specific piece of legislation. I mean, we have the objectives that have been set out in the Fisheries Act. We're obviously here today to discuss the framework and the JFS and the policy ambitions that are within that. And I've also set out just the previous week how we intend to deliver on our own fisheries management strategy, which was published towards the end of 2020. So I don't know what other specific mechanisms or legal mechanisms we would need to bring forward at the moment to enable us to deliver on the policy objectives that we've set out, because I believe that we have the means to do that at the moment.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
And Mercedes.
Thanks, Convener. Given that regional inshore fisheries groups aren't formally constituted or legally accountable, and they don't provide opportunity for public or environmental representation, how will the government ensure transparency and accountability of any fisheries management plans that these groups develop?
I hope I was able to explain, even just partially, my response previously about how the regional inshore fisheries groups have come together, and it was a means of trying to engage with fishers who have been hard to reach, and I think it's vital that we were able to do that work and that we've established that network. But I mean, in terms of engaging with all of our stakeholders, I think that we'd actually covered this a couple of weeks ago when I was at the committee, in terms of the co-management processes. We want to see the people that we want to engage in that as well, and rather than engaging in silos, it's how we can bring our stakeholders together and really collaborate in that sense as well. So of course that's something that we are giving active consideration too, and of course this is out to consultation at the moment, as are our other policies, which I hope all stakeholders will engage with, and happy of course to take any feedback as to how the processes that we have, or any particularly thoughts that various stakeholders have as to how those processes might be improved for the future.
But the principle of transparency and accountability, do you think that's important with these plans?
Yes, I think transparency and accountability is important.
Thank you.
Can we move on to questions now from Alistair Allen?
Thank you, Convener. One of the things that's obviously changed post-Brexit is, potentially anyway, the opportunities that exist for Europe-wide cooperation on fisheries science and innovation. So I just wonder if you could say anything about the Scottish Government's approach to that issue and how it's working with the fishing industry to ensure that that science continues and enjoys support.
Yes, and I suppose I would just want to start by noting that, of course, Marine Scotland Science is recognised for the expertise that we're able to provide. But obviously, through leaving the EU, that means we don't have the same opportunities for collaboration with our EU partners as what we've had, as what we would have had previously. So I don't know whether Paul or Alan would like to elaborate on that, even in terms of, I don't know if there's any specific examples we can provide at the moment in relation to some of those previous collaborations.
Excuse me. Yes, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Of course, as part of the EU and the Common Fisheries Policy previously, we played an active role in regional groups, so the North Sea Regional Group and the North Western Waters Regional Group, in looking at scientific elements primarily around the landing obligation, and there was good cooperation opportunities there for a consistent approach, sometimes too consistent in terms of one size fits all, but that was that's a forum that's been lost. That is balanced out by Marine Scotland Science still being actively involved in ICES, that's the International Council for the Exploration of the Seas, that provides catch advice. That's an international engagement with many, many international partners in there. And an example there that Marine Scotland Science is leading on is pushing that to look at, and I believe Elspeth MacDonald mentioned this in her session this morning, to look at how we manage North Sea cod differently in understanding there are probably a need to manage it geographically in different areas rather than as a an entire area of the North Sea in that sense. So we are still feeding into that international collaboration sense.
But just an additional point I'd like to make on that as well is that obviously we're always looking as to how we can improve our science and collaboration and how we develop evidence. And again, I think that was a point that was raised by Alan at the previous committee session that we had in terms of some of the collaboration that we would like to see and take forward, you know, working with our stakeholders, working with academia, and how we can better collaborate on specific areas that we might wish to look at in the future.
Thank you. Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Just following on from that and some of the evidence that we took in from the last panel, talked about joined-up resources, given that the science budget is limited, joined-up resources between Marine Scotland and Nature Scot. I wonder if you could comment on how you're working to use your scarce resources in the most appropriate manner to provide the right science.
Yeah, and I do think that previous point I touched on about that further collaboration and where we can look to collaborate with other partners is really important. In relation to those, the specific body like and the collaboration and the work that happens with Nature Scot, Paul, I don't know whether you would have any further information on that or put you on the spot.
I'm afraid I do not have any further information on that to hand, but we could always come back in writing on that point.
Great. Thanks, Paul. And the Scottish Government recently published the Future Catching Policy and Remote Electronic Monitoring. And so I'm interested to know how these will both contribute towards the science and the innovation that are set out in the GFS.
I think that they will be, but between the Future and Catching Policy and Remote Electronic Monitoring, I think that they take us a huge step forward in terms of meeting the objectives. Just as I was saying earlier, I mean, we have 8 objectives that are set out on the face of the Act. I won't run through them all now, but I think through the various I was referring in a previous response to Mercedes Villalba about what in relation to the technical and spatial measures and how that means that we'd be delivering on the bycatch ecosystem and climate change objectives, together with REM and the management measures that we're looking to develop, that will also deliver on the sustainability, precautionary and scientific objectives as well. So again, I think through what we're looking to deliver via these 2 policies, I think we're able to meet quite a lot of those objectives. And I think it's really what I set out last week as well, I think it really shows a step change in us leading the world in terms of some of the measures that we're looking to introduce.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Jenny. We move on to questions now from Rachel Hamilton.
Cabinet Secretary, in light of the recent calamitous Scottish Government process for the seasonal closures on the Clyde, what can you say to reassure the fishing industry that participatory decision-making in the spirit of the Joint Fisheries Statement will be followed, and how does the Government intend to do that?
That is a really important question, and I set out to committee last week that in terms of the process that had led us to that SSI coming forward, that wasn't an ideal process, it was far from it, and it didn't reach the standards or meet the standards of co-management that ideally we would like to have and that we have had previously with stakeholders. I apologise for that at the time, but of course we want to ensure, as I said at that committee session, that we learn the lessons of that for the future, because we are committed to, as you said, it's set out in the Act and the Joint Fisheries Statement as well, about the importance of co-management and working with our stakeholders. That's very much what we want to achieve. And again, we've talked today about the Future Catching Policy. Again, that's been developed in consultation and with our stakeholders too. And after the closure, I know that we'd also set out that we intend to engage with all our stakeholders. We'll monitor it throughout the period of the closure and to see how we can improve things or look at things going forward, because that collaboration is really critical. So I have, as I'd said last week, in relation to the Clyde closure, that was far from ideal, but we want to learn lessons from that because co-management is something that is vital and something that we recognise and we want to ensure that we have going forward.
And just to sort of follow up on that, to ensure that this, you know, doesn't happen again, I thank you for your reassurance there. But of course, the ministers have accountability, and I wonder what is there in terms of if this happens again, God forbid, what is in the joint fisheries statement that can prevent that or to ensure it not happening again?
I mean, the JFS wouldn't be the place to set that out or those parameters because, like I say, it's about setting out the high level of ambitions.
But Cabinet Secretary, I mean, it goes through early participation of stakeholders. It says identify issues and potential solutions. It's got it all in there from 3.6.2 to 3.6.4. So therefore, there is a kind of a framework to ensure that the government takes forward exactly that, you know, ensure there is transparency. So I'm just wondering, you know, it's in the trust. We put our trust in ministers. I'm just wondering what is there to ensure that that actually happens, other than your words?
I mean, I think it's also important to remember that as part of this process as well, there are regular reviews and reports on the JFS and the fisheries management plans that we have to introduce. So there'd be reviews on that, I think, every 3 years, and then we have to report on that again every six. So we'll have to show how we've either achieved the policy ambitions that have been set out there in the JFS. But I mean, I would come back to the point that we do have a strong track record of that co-management and of working with our stakeholders. Again, that's what we discussed in relation to the Clyde closure is an example of where that didn't work, which we've accepted. And again, we want to learn the lessons from that because it is important that we do that and we work with our stakeholders as we move forward in implementing the objectives and the policies that are set out in the JFS.
Okay.
A supplementary from Jim Fairley.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted... You possibly remember I was in isolation when you were here talking about the Clyde court box last time, and I missed quite a bit of the evidence that was given. And we were talking earlier on about the engagement with communities and how you have to have that localised. So I don't see, I think you answered that, I don't see how the JFS actually comes into this point about the Clyde court box. But my understanding was that you fully accept that there was bits about what had happened were completely wrong. You've taken the responsibility for that and you're going to move on from there. But I was under the understanding that you took evidence and changed your position during this whole process to have that engagement with the communities that you were working with. So does that not kind of answer Rachel's question that you were already in the process of engagement with people? You got it wrong. And we accept that, but you were actually engaging with them anyway. Would that be fair?
Yeah, we'd listened. I mean, obviously, in relation to the initial SSIs that we'd laid, we listened to our stakeholders as a result of that and tried to bring them together to see if there were means that we could work together to try and find a solution, which is what resulted in the SSI that we discussed last week. So the really still trying to meet the policy objective, which was to protect spawning cod, but also looking at ensuring we're protecting the areas where that spawning takes place, which meant that we were able to reduce the overall closed area by 28% and allowing more fishing activity to take place. So of course, again, the process leading up to that had didn't been ideal, but we did. We tried to listen. I reflected. That's why on the evidence that we'd heard, which is why we were in the position where we'd ultimately changed our position. But listening to our stakeholders and engaging so that we could try and find a solution to some of the issues that had been identified.
Again, just as somebody who doesn't have a huge experience of the fishing industry, it just highlights to me the huge complexity of what it is that you are trying to do in terms of making sure that one sector isn't overly affected by another and everything else that goes with it. So, anyway, okay, thank you.
I would just agree with that and say it is obviously a hugely complex area, and there are lots of balancing and competing interests that we have to try and balance throughout this process. I mean, that's where I think what's set out in the GFS, the framework, and in the Fisheries Act as well, is identifying that there can be those either competing interests and different factors that you have to take account of when you're trying to reach these, you know, what can be really difficult and challenging decisions. So again, while the process in the Clyde Cod closure hadn't been the most straightforward and not the way that we would like to engage with our stakeholders, I do feel like the decision that we reached in terms of the revised closure was the right one.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can we move on to questions from Karen Adam?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, I've been thinking about participation. You know, I've been looking back at statements that were made by Michael Gove back in 2019. He came and he stood in Buckie Harbour, which is in part of my constituency, and he pledged to reverse four decades of the fishing industry decline as he saw it. And we know the rhetoric that was spoken at that time. Having spoken to fishers in my area, they feel betrayed and let down by that rhetoric that was spouted, and they feel that their voices were not heard. And there is a feeling over the last few months in conversations with them that they feel that when it comes to participation and decision making, that it's not always their voices that are being represented. So I'm just wondering, how can the Scottish Government ensure that you know, this participation in decision making has the voices whose lives and livelihoods are going to be directly impacted by the decisions?
No, you're absolutely right. And ensuring that we do hear those voices is critical. And I think, you know, that's referenced throughout the GFS in terms of always looking to consider the impact that decisions will have, not just on the immediate stakeholders, but on our wider communities and things like that too. So we obviously want to make sure that the engagement that we have is as transparent, is as open and inclusive as it can be. Mm-hmm. Of course, there are lots of complex issues to try and balance within that, you know, whether that's and we've got to make sure ultimately that we have a healthy marine environment. Mm-hmm. We want to make sure that we have a profitable fishing industry, which obviously provides a sustainable source of protein, mm-hmm. which is vital for us and for our diet. And it's trying to make sure that we're getting the balance between all these different considerations right. But I do think you're absolutely right. We want to make sure that the people that are most impacted by the decisions that we're taking are part of that process and that we are working with them. And as I'd highlighted in previous responses, you know, we do have a strong track record of that co-management, of engagement with our stakeholders. There's a variety of different forums that we have to engage with different stakeholders too. But as I'd also said in a response, I think it's important that we don't just consider these in different silos either, and it's about bringing our stakeholders together to see how we can really find a way forward through some of the really complex issues that we face mm-hmm. right now, and that no doubt we're going to face going into the future with some of the other challenging decisions that we'll have to take.
That's great, thank you.
Thank you. Questions now from Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Convener. In the last group, when they gave evidence to the committee, they said there was some conflicts over where they could fish or where they could carry out activities. And I guess we all accept there's a conflict on where certain activities can take place. You know, we've got to balance nature, renewables, aquaculture, fishing, tourism. All of those have got to be balanced. I wouldn't say we've got it right at the moment. Do you think that we will be able to get that right? Is that going to come under the GFS, or is that something that you're going to come up with so that the GFS is based on a sustainable idea of how we're going to use the areas of our coastline?
Mm-hmm. I mean, that is my ultimate aim, and I want to make sure that we do get that right and we deliver on that. But, you know, as I was just alluding to in my previous response, it is really challenging because I think while it seems that we have a huge sea area surrounding us and a large part of the coastal area, it's an increasingly busy space with lots of different competing interests that we have to try and manage. Some of that we're working our way through just now to see how we can try and balance all the interests there. Because obviously with specific stocks, they'll only be in a specific area or at a specific time. You mentioned renewable energy, We have our marine protected area network as well, and we'll soon have highly protected marine areas which we'll be looking to develop. So that's some of that work is what we're in the process of looking at the moment. Of course, as we have statutory processes to follow when it comes to whether that's establishing MPAs or looking at the planning and consenting process for offshore renewables as well. But these are issues that we're very much trying to get to grips with and to ensure that we're as fair and balanced as possible. And there is some reference to that within the JFS and where it talks of some of the other measures and making sure that the ambitions that are set out in the JFS are aligned with other management measures that it talks about with MPAs. But there's no doubt this is really difficult. It's a really complex area, but one where I hope we'll be able to work our way through.
And Cabinet Secretary, do you think you'll be able to think, or when you're considering this, think far enough forward? Because, for example, aquaculture have said that it's no longer really sustainable for them to be as close inshore as they are at the moment due to water temperatures and the problems with disease and lice that brings, and they want to drift further offshore, which may bring them into conflict with renewable, whether it be turbines or wave energy. How are you going to plan for the future and make it flexible enough to cope with the future demands of all the industries that Scotland wants to support?
Mm-hmm. I think a lot of that work and some of what you mentioned there will be harnessed. You know, I talked about in my opening statement the PFG commitment that we have for the Blue Economy Action Plan, and that we'll be setting out a Blue Economy Vision, recognising the breadth of sectors that we have within our marine environment and those different interests, and making sure all the strategies and policies that we have across all these different areas are aligned and take cognizance of each other as much as possible. So obviously we'd been undertaking work on aquaculture, which I'm sure you'll be aware of in the review that we've undertaken there. There's a number of other strands of work that are ongoing there at the moment. So I think it is vital that we capture all of that, we set out our clear vision for the future and how all of these will operate together
okay.
for a sustainable blue economy.
And Cabinet Secretary, just the final question for me, Convener, if it's all right, is just that, you know, each of those industries contribute different amount to Scotland, whether it's financially or whether it's, I don't know, supporting the local economy by encouraging people to live there. So how will you balance out the economic benefits of each of these industries and not disadvantage the maybe less economic commitments that are made by some So, I don't know, creel fishers who are really important to the local economy. I don't see how you get that balance, but will you be able to achieve it, Cabinet Secretary?
I certainly hope so, because that is part of the challenge, is the balancing of all these different interests. And like you say, I mean, in the overall, when you look at, you know, inshore fisheries, for example, and the huge importance that there is to the local economies and communities. I'd had a meeting with Dr. Allen and some of his constituents not that long ago, where we were talking about that, you know, the impacts of these industries, the employment, what that means for population in some of our most remote and rural locations is really important. And of course, as Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands, making sure that we get that balance, that we're enabling people to live and work in our remote, in our most remote and rural and island communities is of course vital, but I'm not proposing or to say that I have all the solutions to that today or can say exactly how that, but it does highlight that these are some of the complexities that we have to try and balance and that we certainly take into consideration when we're considering some of these other areas.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We'll be watching closely. Thank you, Camille.
I'm sure you will.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, how will the Fisheries Framework Outline Agreement and the Memorandum of Understanding and the Joint Fisheries Statement, how will they all manage to work together to manage cross-UK governance of fisheries?
Hopefully they should all work together very well in terms of meeting the overall objectives. So we have the overall framework, and I think I'd outlined that in my opening statement, that unlike other frameworks that I know the committee will be considering, this predates that, which is why it's almost split into two parts. So we have the Joint Fisheries Statement, which sets out the overall policy ambitions that all the administrations would look to achieve as part of the framework. We also have the Memorandum of Understanding that really goes through some of the, I suppose, the day-to-day elements sense of how we would work to, how the different administrations would work together, how we would resolve any potential conflicts if they arose. And within the Memorandum of Understanding, there's also the operational agreements as well, which is looking at some of the more day-to-day and technical issues that we would look to align on. So I think together it's quite a cohesive package of measures that should enable us to hopefully to work together in a positive way. And as I was saying at the start of the session as well, I think the overall ambitions that we've set out and the fact that, you know, as four different administrations, we've all been able to agree and we're aligned on the overarching ambitions that are set out in the GFS is really positive. And I think it shows that we can work together effectively in areas such as this while respecting devolved competence too.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions from Ariane Burgess?
Thank you, Convener. I'm aware of the potential for the Subsidy Control Bill to constrain the Scottish Government's ability to diverge from the UK Government on subsidy levels and policies. Cabinet Secretary, could I ask for your views on how the Subsidy Control Bill might affect the operation of the Fisheries Management and Support Common Framework with regards to fisheries grants and subsidies?
I think it would probably be fair to say that I don't think that the UK Government themselves have really thought through how the Fisheries Act, the Internal Market Act and the Subsidy Control Bill will all work together or align in that sense. And I think we've certainly not been, it's certainly not been made clear to us how fisheries and aquaculture within the with them being within the overall remit of the Subsidy Control Bill, what the full ramifications of that will be. So that's where we essentially need to see that further guidance as to how that legislation is going to work in practice. But I think certainly from what we've seen so far, there hasn't been that full consideration as to the interaction between these really key pieces of legislation. I mean, I don't know if this is a point that either Paul or Alan would like to elaborate on either.
No specific... Not much more to add, just note that yes, there is a number of different bills, which the Cabinet Secretary has already mentioned, between UKIM, United Kingdom Internal Market Act, the Subsidy Control Bill. There is grant and subsidy provisions contained within the Fisheries Act itself and within the framework. Exactly how all these provisions work together is still a work in progress.
Rachel.
Yeah. Is there any intention through that, you know, operational planning on the MOU, is there any intentional discussion between the four administrations on a sort of shared IT platform to deliver those specific objectives?
The objectives within
the subsidy grants that Paul mentioned.
Oh, right. I'm not aware if those discussions have taken place yet, or I don't know if either Paul or Alan could provide more information on that.
I'm afraid I don't have much more information to provide. We do already within Scotland have a platform which goes and tracks our grants and subsidies that we hand out to the industry, or awards, should I say, to the industry. That is, the other administrations also have their own platforms. I'm not aware of any discussions that are underway to build a common joint platform, but we do have systems that allow us to go and jointly report or compile who is getting awarded what, if that makes sense.
And I think it also just have to be clear on what the benefits or otherwise of something like that would be, which again, given it's something we've not considered, isn't work that's been done.
Okay, I just mentioned it just to put it on the record that it is as part of that MOU, so it does say that success evaluation delivery mechanisms such as the use of common IT platforms, so it's maybe something to watch for the future.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and your officials. We seem to have drawn to a close early, and you may get half an hour back of your day. I'd like to thank you and your officials for providing evidence this morning, and we will move on to agenda item 3 in a minute or two. Thank you. We'll now move on to agenda item 3, which is consideration of a consent notification for a UK statutory instrument, the import of animals and animal products and approved countries, EU exit amendment regulation 2022. I refer members to papers 3 and 4 from page 23. Do any members have any comments on this industry, on this instrument, sorry? Are members content to agree with the Scottish Government's decision to consent to the provisions set out in the notification being included in UK rather than Scottish subordinate legislation? Content. Is the committee content to delegate authority to me to respond to the Government and, in doing so, to include the information set out in paragraph 2 of Annex A of paper 4? That concludes our business in public, and we will now move into private session.